What was something that stayed with you after you came back?
Probably just the overall experience. I was very moved by everything,
right.
And it was kind of, it was, I've never done something like that before. I'd never been on my own in that way, so it was a good growth experience for
sure.
me, because I was really
You were
young.
18.
Yeah, I,
so
went
she,
when I was 18.
And you had never been
school.
Anywhere outside of
No. Never,
California.
Never traveled to another country before, and never without my family, so it was the first time I ever did anything like that, but
right.
I'm glad I did it.
And I think, you know, a lot of parents are probably thinking about maybe how that transition went. If it's, was it easy, or was it,
well,
did you
it
feel
was,
safe
it
there?
Was very, like, overwhelming. I almost felt like I was dreaming, like, when I first got there, but it was an easy adjustment, because everyone, it was almost like everyone felt that way,
mm-hmm.
so we all kind of, like, settled together and had a good moment of,
okay.
like, sitting in.
Yeah, so you guys will go over in a group, and we'll meet again, and you can meet your roommates before you go, or meet people and choose your roommates. And what was your experience like?
I just want to ask, how many of you have not been farther away from home than like 500 miles?
Half.
Cool. You're going to be so excited when you're over there and get back. You're going to say, this is the best decision I ever made.
Right.
It's just, it creates a confidence in you. I went when I was 18. I went for a whole year, and I had to speak the German language the whole time, and there wasn't anybody speaking language, so that was different. You're going to be cool because it's going to be English the whole time. You got these two professors that are fantastic, so you can't lose by going. I'm telling you, it's for me. It was the most important decision of my life until I was like 30. It seriously was. It changed my whole life. So if you're excited about doing something different, getting away from your parents for just a little bit, it doesn't mean drinking and partying. I mean making decisions on your own, proving to yourself that you can do something. Go to Florence.
Good speech. Yes. I agree. Okay, and what was the biggest difference for you, or the hardest thing to adjust to in Italy and Florence?
Probably money.
Money.
Yeah.
You gotta plan out.
You have to plan it out and budget yourself, because you can end up spending a lot more than you think you are, because it's in euros, so it seems cheaper than
right.
it actually is. And
yeah.
then another thing is water. Bring water with you
yeah.
everywhere,
water.
Because they charge water for you in restaurants, so I
ah.
just carried a bottle of water.
Pro tip, I like that one.
Yeah.
And then, what is something you wish you knew, you know, before
how cold
you went?
It was.
Yeah.
Ah, good,
okay.
good one. Good one.
Definitely, it was really, really cold, and it was almost shockingly cold. Especially because I've always been here in Southern California with the sun, and even getting off the plane in Germany, I was like, all the breath got taken out of me, and it was so freezing cold. So that's something I should say is bring like clothes on the plane.
Mm-hmm.
It's really cold when you get there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think some students arrived and they lost their bags. So bring your carry-on warm
yeah,
clothes
for sure.
with you.
Because
I think they arrived with no jacket
yeah.
and flip-flops.
Like flip-flops.
They came like
this.
Yeah.
Like this. Don't take any of the clothes you're wearing now except maybe jeans.
Right.
Because it won't be warm enough.
Yeah.
Think New York City.
Right.
Yeah.
What was the coldest that it got when
like,
you were out there?
Oh.
24.
Yeah. I remember I saw like 28. But it's in Celsius out there, so it was like 0 or like -2 or something like that. So it looked cold, but
that
it
was
really
the biggest
cold.
Shocker probably.
Yeah.
And then it warmed up, right?
Yeah.
Was that just a freakishly cold winter or something?
It was unusually cold.
And then maybe students, I always get the question about language. You know, how is it navigating?
Can I say one?
Yes.
Yeah.
There's 9,000 international students in Florence in a school year, so there's English. But you do want to know how to have conversations. You want to know how to say thank you and please and excuse me on the street. You don't want to be the American that just pushes through. And don't be drinking your coffee or eating food going down the street. That's so American and so frowned upon. But yes, there's English everywhere. So that's not a stumbling block, particularly if you're Spanish speaking as your first language or even second language. Very helpful.
Yeah. What do you guys have any questions?
Well, I was
going to
say, as we present, you guys, please feel free to chime in whenever you'd like.
Right.
The PowerPoints will be an impetus for other questions and other thoughts that you have.
Will you stick around?
Yeah, I'll stick around.
Because maybe we can throw it to both
sure.
of you.
Yeah.
And then we'll hold the questions until the end, because we'll answer any of your questions. Then we'll open it up, and if you guys have questions for them, you can ask them. Okay. Thank you so much. And we'll begin with Mike. So, is this?
Please chime in.
This one's you.
I will chime.
So, I'm Mike Hillman. I have the privilege of teaching in the study abroad program again.
Can I ask you to stand by the computer?
Okay. I tend to move around.
Do you want me?
I'll be teaching the Art 100 Renaissance to Rococo. So, if you look through a Renaissance art history book, page after page, almost every single page is what we're actually going to be seeing in person. So I think I come from more of a visual point of view. I'm also an artist. And Senya teaching humanities come maybe from a little more cerebral point of view. So I think it's a perfect combination. That's a good way to put it, right?
Definitely cerebral.
Definitely cerebral. And so I think it's a good combination. I think we're going to hit all the different aspects of Italy and particularly the art. So the trip is January 4th through February 2nd, and this is the main cathedral we'll see, Santa Maria de Fiore. We'll actually have the opportunity to climb up through Brunelleschi's dome and perch ourselves up there and see a magnificent view of the whole city. So we'll do that towards the beginning. So what's nice about that is you get the lay of the land. You can see how close all the different buildings actually are. Because I like to say the whole city of Florence is sort of like Disneyland. You know, you could walk across one part of the town to the other part very easily. And our apartments or our homes will be all throughout the city. So, there we go. It will be winter, as Victoria and Dot said. And it's probably the most shocking thing. You'll have to layer your clothes. But we'll get into all that once you decide to go. We didn't have that kind of snow. This was our winter. There was still a Christmas tree up.
Okay.
So Senya again will be teaching Humanities 102, the Renaissance through the 19th century. And the next slide I'll be teaching Art 103, Renaissance Art History. Okay. We'll see the Duomo, and you can see the people up here on sort of the cupola, the top part, enjoying the views. And the students from 2017 having fun. You can see how they're bundled up. We'll see.
Yeah, scarves are a good thing.
Scarves, like guys who go like, I never worn a scarf in my life. People might think
nobody wears.
No, no. Everyone wears scarves, sweaters, hats. We see the baptistry, San Giovanni Baptistry. We do a lot of looking and studying the doors and the competition to create the bronze doors. I have about 140 slides, so I'll go over real quick. Anything you want to chime in? The Ponte Vecchio, the old bridge. And we'll be fortunate to be there during something called F Light, which is a celebration, you might say, where they light the different monuments in the city with sort of contemporary lighting. So we'll be able to see that. The Uffizi is the main painting and drawing museum. We'll spend maybe like a half a day in the Uffizi. We'll see things like Botticelli's Birth of Venus, Caravaggio's Medusa, Michelangelo's Holy Family, the Piazza della Signoria and the Palazzo Vecchio. This is sort of the main sort of public square in the center of the city, and it has, not hundreds, but some of the most beautiful artwork in the city that we'll see. We'll talk about those. This is John Bologna's Rape of the Sabine Women, and Neptune. And up in the left, this is called the Lanzi Loggia, which is sort of an outdoor sculpture museum. So we'll be looking at all that work. We'll have guided tours of most of these things. the art part of the course is we'll learn about how to look at art, how to study, how to describe it. And we sort of leave the guides up to a little more of the history in the background. Okay? We see the actual original David in academia, but there is a copy in front of the Palazzo Vecchio that we'll see. The Bargello, we'll spend one morning in the Bargello, and that's the sculpture museum. And we'll see various sculptures, Donatello's David, Michelangelo's Bacchus, and Mercury by John Bologna. One of the buildings that people seem to walk by, thousands walk by it, and it's one of the most spectacular buildings, is called the Or San Michele. And you basically see the history of Renaissance sculpture around the building if you walk around it. It was a competition, basically. They had built this building, and they said, we'll build the building, and all the different guilds will put a sculpture that relates to their forte, okay? If it's the sculptors or the iron workers, they had to create a sculpture. It stalled, and then over the years, finally it got going again. So we'll see that, and on the interior is this beautiful Madonna that we'll see then. Okay, so that's the Or San Michele. We'll spend a lot of time going to different churches around the city. Santa Maria Novella, most famous for the Holy Trinity by Masaccio, and Santa Croce. And the interior Santa Croce, probably most famous for all the various Italians who were buried there, such as Michelangelo, Dante, Galileo. Not too many of the Medici's. The Medici Chapel, a few Medici's. So we'll go to Santa Croce. One of the first days, Sandy and I are working on the actual itinerary, when we're going to do what, but close to the beginning, we'll go to Santa Maria del Carmine and the Brancacci Chapel, and we'll discuss why that fresco is so important. We do go to the Academia to see the original David. And sort of on the northern part of the town, a lot of people don't mosey up to this area, but a beautiful, beautiful convent, San Marcos, a monastery. And if you know anything about history, this is where Savonarola lived. And he created a lot of, let's say, controversy and issues and change. So we'll study a little bit about Savonarola and why San Marcos is so magnificent. One of the frescoes we'll see is this one by Fra Angelico. We go to San Lorenzo and spend probably two different days there. We'll see the main church, we'll see the Medici Chapel, we'll see what's called the Laurentian Library and the steps by Michelangelo, which are on the next steps, our slides rather. So we see the Medici Chapel, and our guide that we'll have for quite a few different excursions, Angela, while we were in the Medici Chapel in 2017, she brought up the fact that, you guys, you are so lucky. You have seen actually 97% of every single work that Michelangelo has created. And it just gave me goosebumps again, but it gave this, that was one of the facts that the students didn't realize. You'll see almost every single work that Michelangelo created that is still around. Okay, so we'll go to the Medici Chapel, see night and day. This is, as we move from the Renaissance, a little bit later in the Renaissance, we move into something called Mannerism, where things started to get elongated and modified, you might say, or abstracted. So this is pretty much a revolutionary idea to have a beautiful staircase on the inside of a building. It never been done. So this is by Michelangelo. We'll look at that. We go to the Pitti Palace, and the Pitti Palace has six or eight different museums that we'll spend some time looking through these museums. On the back of the Pitti Palace is beautiful gardens called the Boboli Gardens, which is on the next slide. We go to the Palazzo Medici Riccardi to see the procession of the Magi. It's a little chapel, probably no bigger than from that wall to here, square. Spectacular, takes up most of the whole room. Okay. The day we go to San Marcos, right next to San Marcos, you'll find that public transportation is amazing. You could get anywhere you want to go relatively cheaply and easily.
And you'll get home and wish, why can't we just walk a quarter of a mile and get on a bus? Why can't we just go a quarter of a mile and get to the train station and go just about anywhere in Italy? But right next to San Marcos is the main hub for buses. And so we'll go up to Fiesole for an afternoon, and it's about a 15-minute bus ride up the hill. If you're into Roman artworks, there's a Roman amphitheater and a lot of ruins up there. Sort of on the other side of the hill, if you look over here, this is sort of where Fiesole is. And on this side, smaller hill, is Piazza di Michelangelo, which is sort of a plateau, you might say. Just above the plateau is a church called San Miniato a Monte. And one of the oldest churches in Florence has a beautiful crypt that I would encourage. We plan most of the sort of morning, afternoon activities, sort of a main activity, the classroom stuff. But a lot of times I'll say, hey, I want to go listen to the monks do the Gregorian chant at 4 o'clock. You're welcome to join me. So that's one of the things I like to do. Again, it's a beautiful spot for photos. Santa Felicita is sort of right by the Ponte Vecchio. It's sort of a hidden little church, but last winter when I was there, it was the first time this painting had been out of the church. They had an exhibition, and they included this painting in the exhibition, and so it was brilliantly lit. In the church, it's sort of behind gates, and you can't really see it. So hopefully we'll have the opportunity to see various shows in a different context than normal, okay? But one of the beautiful, great things about going and traveling abroad is seeing the artwork where it was meant, okay, in context, or in concepto, as they say, okay? y'all know the Last Supper? Who's the most famous Last Supper? Who made it? Who painted it? Leonardo da Vinci, and it's in Milan. But having said that, there are 9 different cenacolos, or Last Suppers. Can Senya say it better than Mr. Hillman?
Cenacolo, you do.
Okay. Because I used to say cenacola. cenacolo. There's 9 different Last Suppers in and around Florence. And I hadn't seen them all up until last winter when I made a point to go to all of them. So one of the main things I'm going to do as part of the Art 103 is have the students, have you compare and contrast the different stylistically, iconography, just why they change and the reasons for that, okay? So I think that'll be, for me, it's going to be a highlight, hopefully for you too. So when someone says, oh, Leonardo's Last Supper, you can say, there's better. Or there's different. How's that? Okay? We do a number of day trips that are planned and part of the whole experience. One is a day trip to Siena. Siena is probably most famous for the Palio, which is a horse race that happens twice a year. So we'll hear all about that. It's a beautiful, old feeling town that you could walk around in one afternoon. So we go to Siena. Magnificent cathedral and interior. And Victoria, in that shot?
Mm-hmm. Did you see how we're bundled up?
It looks pretty cold.
I don't know. Probably not, but I've been eating.
Dot, are you in there?
Probably somewhere.
Anyways. Okay. The same day we go to San Gimignano, most famous for the large towers. A lot of them have, over the years, disappeared, but there's still several. And also for this spot right here, which many people, not me, say is the best gelato in Italy. I have my favorite. Senya has her favorite. We'll talk about that and share with that as we're around.
Try to win your allegiance.
Right. This is Lucy. She was a student about 7 years ago.
Oh.
She is now the art teacher at Bonita High School.
Is this the third time that you will do this in Florence?
Yeah. Third time together.
Third time the dream team, yes.
Okay.
Yeah, dream team,
cool.
Yeah, the dream team.
Third time's a charm, right?
Yeah. And we are there in winter. This was a summer shot. It won't be that green, but we will be traveling through Tuscany. There's also the option of going to Rome. And in Rome, we see, of course, St. Peter's, And Trevi Fountain, Bernini's magnificent sculpture. We'll talk a lot about that. We see the Pantheon and the Colosseum and the group. I think that was the first year I went.
What year was that?
2010, 9.
In the summer, that one.
Yeah,
but then it was
the summer.
Too hot.
This was the summer we went. The first summer I went, it was extraordinarily hot.
And it's more crowded too, right?
And it's jammed. So if you're considering, like, well, I'm going to wait till the summer. It's really beautiful in the winter. You know, you could just put more clothes on and be warm. But the crowds are like half or two thirds less. Going into restaurants in the summer, you know, the Italians eat very late. You know, you might get there at 9 o'clock and there'll be no one there, but by 11, 12, they're packed in the evening. In the winter time, you don't need to make any sort of reservations. You just walk in. So there's a lot of advantages of going in the winter. Also, what I think is really nice about this trip is you get 6 units of credit done in 4 weeks' time while you're in Italy. Okay.
Or three, you don't have to do.
Yeah, you don't have to take both classes, but you can. This was actually a shot from our hotel in Rome.
Wow.
Yeah, it was pretty magnificent. I was like, guys, go out, do stuff. And we're like, no, we're just going to sit on the terrace. It's so beautiful. Again, we go into St. Peter's and inside. Pietà by Michelangelo. Sistine Chapel. Actually, in 2017, we're in the Sistine Chapel. And again, in the summer, it was jam-packed. And you know, you're kind of like this walking through. But in the winter, it was open. And you could walk around and you'd actually look up. And we were just talking about being Catholic. And this is the Last Judgment by Michelangelo on the back wall. And a priest came to a microphone and said, would anyone like to? And so I, you know, I remember the confession a long time, and so I walked up there. So again, I get goosebumps thinking about these sort of things. I was able to do confession standing underneath the Last Judgment of the priest. And the students said I was kind of like levitating. I was just so excited and just unplanned. So there'll be a lot of unplanned, spontaneous. Hopefully, you'll be able to embrace those things, like getting stuck in Germany and spending the night in Germany. Hopefully that won't happen.
Okay.
So again, we see Michelangelo's Sistine Chapel. We'll go to the Borghese, which is a phenomenal museum. It's in Rome, but it's in sort of like a park area. And this is Bernini's Daphne and Apollo. If you don't know about Bernini, you'll learn a lot about him and really, I hope, appreciate the beauty and the sort of just the skill and talent it took to create these magnificent works of art. Adjacent to that, sort of down the hill, it's sort of like the Rodeo Drive of Rome, is the Convent of the Cappuccini, and it's decorated with all the different skulls and bones. So that's sort of like an optional thing. We'll do that afternoon if you'd like to. Last year, Cindy and I, or in 2017, Cindy and I, it wasn't included in the trip, but a lot of people wanted to go to Venice. So we took a day trip to Venice, and it turned out to be, what do you think?
It was really fun.
It was really fun.
It snowed.
It snowed. So it was, that's what I wanted to give it. Again, it was magical. It was one of the most magical days I've ever had, because we got the forecast, and it was supposed to rain. The AIFS representative said, Mike, it's going to pour. It's supposed to pour rain. And you're outside, and you're on canals, and there's like no really sidewalks, the planks of wood. Anyways, so it's supposed to pour rain, and we get there, and it's like, sun's out. And we got to where we're going, which is the next slide, I think, the Guggenheim. Nope, we go to San Marcos, the Rialto Bridge. The Guggenheim, Peggy Guggenheim's collection. Again, you don't have to go. If you'd like to, I'll take you there. It has one of the absolute best contemporary and modern art collections in the world. You'll see like the best Picasso, the best Braque, the best, there's more slides of it there. Anyways, it's a phenomenal little museum, okay? Santa Maria Glorioso de Fiari, these are Bellini and Titian. Again, in situ, these are painted for those walls and they're still sitting right there. So we go through the day, we make our way through all these things, and we get back to the train station by 6 o'clock, the train leaves at 7, and we're like, oh, okay, okay, okay. Everyone gets there and we're like, oh my God, it starts to snow. So here we are looking at the canals, just absolutely magnificent.
That's probably the first time some
it
students...
It hadn't snowed in years and years and years and years and years, and years. So we happened
right.
to see a beautiful sunny day turn into a snowy evening.
And maybe students had never seen snow.
Oh, most of the students had never seen it actually snow. So to be
right.
in Venice on the canals, looking at that, look at her expression. I just love that photo. She's just overwhelmed with joy.
That probably will not happen.
We're going to try to make it happen.
Yeah, AIFS. Get on that, AIFS.
Again, we take a day trip for those who want to go to Pisa. And again, these day trips, they're not part of the package, you might say, but it's maybe 10 euros, 12 euros round trip on train to get, I mean, less than the cost of going to a movie. You could get to Pisa and see the Leaning Tower if that's something you'd like to do. The same day, because it's kind of adjacent, it's a close by, is this beautiful little town called Lucca. Lucca is a walled city. And you could actually rent bikes and ride a bike around the entire city up on top of the wall. So there's a group of students during the summer, but I did it last winter. It's easy to do in the winter also and fun. Again, and maybe you might want to go to Assisi if you know anything about St. Francis. I think, and we had an amazing talk several years ago about St. Francis. And to me, it was sort of the start of the Renaissance. He was the one who said, well, look around you, beauty and God and all what is good is around you. It's not necessarily in a church. It's look at the environment. That is beauty. That is God. That is what is important in your lives. Not following the rules, you know, not doing what was very common in the medieval period to sort of sequester and keep quiet. So anyway, so we learn about St. Francis, and Assisi is a beautiful town. We're used to seeing sort of brown and kind of not dirty, but sort of terracotta-y, brownish cities, and all of a sudden you get to Assisi, and it's beautiful white stone everywhere. Just a beautiful town. Okay, and then about the school, this is Martha, who, is Martha still there?
I believe so.
Martha will be one of the people at the school in Florence. This is the classroom, and this is the building. So it's not a, you know, 21st century building. It's from the 18th century or even older. So there's frescoes on the ceiling. It's got a little out of whack here. This is San Lorenzo Market. Include that just because it's a, in the last three years probably, they remodeled the entire top floor. So it's a nice place to have a very casual lunch or dinner where you don't have to necessarily be at a restaurant, very formal, but you could get all different types of food. It's sort of like a food, food court. So there's the sort of food court. And of course, there's several different places for pizza, but my favorite is the Pizza Man, Il Pizzaiolo. And another place that I love is Mario's. Mario's is only open for lunch, and you can see all the people standing outside. That's typical in the summer. In the winter, if you know when it opens, you can get there right away. But what's unique about Mario's and a lot of the Italian food is it's all local, and they actually don't have refrigerators or freezers at Mario's because they buy the food, they cook the food, you eat it, and you're done. Okay, so and you can really tell the difference. So Mario's is a really typical trattoria, if you want a very traditional lunch. And the students enjoying.
There's Victoria. I see.
There you are. Okay. And of course, the different opportunities for gelato are everywhere. And another thing that if you're not into drinking coffee, you might want to try to take it up for a trip to Italy because the coffee is really, really delicious. As we have something called like happy hour, the aperitivo.
Mm-hmm.
And one
spritz.
Of the most famous little drinks they have is a spritz, which is like a Campari with sparkling wine or water. And then there's always the opportunity to go out at night and do other things. Okay. This is a typical, this is one of the students' palazzos or students' apartments. Generally, it's about 4 or 5 students per apartment. And I think that makes it very unique. We're not in dorms, we're not in apartment buildings, but we're actually in various spots throughout the city. Dot had a magnificent place. She opened the French doors and there was the Duomo. She
wow.
was on the 3rd or 4th floor up and she looked right to the side. That was a little noisy for her, but it was spectacular view.
But from my bed, I looked up on the ceiling and there was this fantastic fresco.
Yeah,
it was fantastic.
It's crazy that you can stay. You're staying in these apartments that are older than this country.
This country.
That's nuts. What's that?
And then actually, most of the places, not most, but a lot of them do have elevators because we're on the 3rd, 4th, 5th floors, things like that. So, anyway, some images of the students in these are their houses. This was my assistant Lynn went a couple years ago. This is her place. They all have kitchens, so if you want to cook there, that's perfectly acceptable and a good thing to do. You may want to go out and have coffee in the morning and then stop by and get some groceries and between your group fix a simple lunch.
Did you cook
a
lot when
dinner?
You're out there?
Not a lot, but we had some nights where we stayed in because we were trying to save money.
Yeah,
mostly.
Right.
And then we had little dinner nights together.
Okay.
Fun.
Yeah.
Did you cook often?
No, my housemate didn't like to cook. He wanted to eat out.
Yeah, well, I mean.
Get Italian
good,
food.
Good reason to do that.
Yeah.
This is my place.
It's fashionable.
Yeah. Yeah, you see a lot of IKEA stuff there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And, again, there's art everywhere. This is a local, might call him street artist, but he takes the signs that are already there and creates things that are pretty special. And this was, I think we went to Cinque Terre one year, and this was a graffiti on the wall. It says, "You can't teach experience. I fell in love with Italia." Becky Walsh, 2011. So the idea is that your experience it, you're not necessarily learning about it in books. Just a short video. This is from an 18-year-old student's perspective. He took all the photos, and again, from his perspective.
Thank you. So we have Paula from AIFS here.
So good morning. Thank you for coming. We're so happy that you're interested in study abroad and this wonderful experience. So some of this presentation is repeated, so I'll skip over those slides because I want to get you out of here in the next 20, 25 minutes. But my name is Paula Messina, and I'm with AIFS Study Abroad. We are the study abroad organization that works in conjunction with Citrus to provide this program and the semester programs that we do. We were founded in 1964, so we have over 54 years of experience in study abroad. And in all of those years, we've sent over 1.5 million students abroad to over 20 countries. I think right now we're in 25 different countries. I myself was a study abroad student with AIFS. When I was a junior in college, I wanted to get to Spain. I was a Spanish major and spoke just barely intermediate level. So I went to Granada with AIFS and spent the year there. So I'm one of those 1.5 million students, and that's how I started my relationship, my love relationship, definitely with study abroad. We've been partnered with Citrus College and the consortium that Citrus College founded for study abroad, the Southern California Foothills Consortium, since 1989. So next fall 19, will be the 30th anniversary of study abroad and AIFS at Citrus College. I think our forte are the two second points that we have. We have local program coordinators. So our Florence office has a bunch of staff. I think there are 5 staff members who have all studied abroad themselves, and we did the program in, you know, some of them are Italian and they did it maybe in England. Others did it in Florence themselves, and they are Southern Californians. As a matter of fact, Trung was at Pasadena City College and studied abroad with AIFS, and he's now working in our office there. So it's nice that they all have experience in the field and experience in Florence. They all live there full time now. And then the fact that we have extensive incident response and crisis management protocol, right? So we are there. We set up the program in conjunction with your faculty and with Citrus College to make the program run as smoothly as possible and to make it as healthy and safe a experience as possible, right? So we have all of this incident response and crisis management procedure that we have written down and that our staff is trained in. So it might be something as simple as, my debit card won't work, what do I do? Our staff knows how to help you through that crisis, because it could be, you know, a crisis. It could be something as serious as something that ends up on the news. Hopefully not, but anything, you know, that could possibly happen, know that we have these procedures that are there to get our students through the crisis as smoothly and as healthy as possible. And then just very briefly, why study abroad? We like to think about study abroad as an investment in your education, right? We had our former students and your faculty describe this wonderful transformative experience, which certainly it is for everyone. But think about it as something that will help you in the transfer process and something that will help you in the employment process, right? It is a global market nowadays, and having that international experience on your transcript and on your resume will set you apart from at least 90% of your peers. So it definitely has a return on investment and long-term effects. And we went through why Florence. I mean, I'm ready to go. We have students travel all around Europe and around Italy. The brochure that John, or the flyer that John is going to get you, has our schedule, our itinerary. It would be departing the U.S. on January 4th. Overnight flight, all our European flights are overnight, arriving in Florence. Your first day in Florence will be an orientation ending with a guided tour. Your classes will begin on Monday, January 7th, and then you'll have daily activities and class and ending and departing on Saturday, February 2nd. You, as far as your academics, just know that the courses are all UCCSU transferable, so they all tick boxes on the iGetSE. They all transfer to CSU. So the idea is that study abroad will keep you on track for graduation. They all meet Gen Ed requirements, and you can take one or both classes, absolutely. Sandy, we didn't hear from you. Would you like to have a little?
So I'm the cerebral one, humanities 102. And I would just say that as an instructor taking students to Florence, the most wonderful thing is we get to throw away the textbook and use the city as our textbook, as our experience. As Mike's going through all the slides, it can seem overwhelming as you're looking at all the art and the places and you think, how in the world are we doing this in 4 weeks? But I think Mike and I really see that as our job, to take the class time that we have scheduled and to get you out and seeing things and experiencing them as much as we can, and then giving you enough of a foundation that you can go and explore on your own time. And we recognize that that's equally important. I love teaching the humanities in Florence because it is fundamentally a study of human expression and what that means to you. And so it's really a chance to reflect on the things that you see, how they resonate with you or how they don't resonate with you, to think about the way that people have experienced things in literature, in music, in performance, in art, in architecture. And Florence is an absolute dream place to get to do that. And so it really is a special opportunity. We tend to teach a 4-day week. So we pack Monday through Thursday mornings. I was checking with Victoria when I was talking with one of my classes this week. What time do you think we wrapped up? And she said, for a really hungry lunch. Like, we were really ready to go to lunch when you were done. But then we really want to leave Friday, Saturday, and Sunday as days when you can go and explore and travel, and then come back and share with your classmates about what you've seen and done, and sort of spread that experience around. So Humanities 102 is just, it's, if there's icing on a cake, I don't even know what's above the icing. It is the most wonderful thing to get to teach in Florence, and I really enjoy getting to share that experience.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Mike, any more?
I think I said enough.
Okay.
Again, we try not to dwell on book work sort of thing, but we're seeing it right in front of our eyes, so there's no real point in going into discussion of a David when you're standing.
Okay. All right, so you had some photos of the AFS Study Center right there in the middle of Florence. Just so, it's located in a 13th century palazzo, so even the building where you're studying is historic, right next to what was the old Roman amphitheater there. You have Wi-Fi and a computer lab there, so you have a lot of modern amenities. Your AFS student advisors are located there. They're on call 24/7. So you have regular office hours, but there is an emergency phone that is rotated between staff. You'll have someone to contact if you ever have an emergency. We'll have an orientation program. We'll actually start a month before departure. Someone will be here on Citrus campus. We'll have a pre-departure orientation meeting where we'll get you ready for the trip, give you sort of a heads up of what to expect for your first few days. We'll continue with a solid orientation program once you arrive in Florence. Our staff will give you a meeting. Your faculty will also give you an academic orientation. We'll continue with a guided tour of Florence and a welcome reception. Here is where you are, right in the center of Florence, which is amazing, right next to the Piazza Santa Croce and the Santa Croce Church. You're literally just around the corner. Most of your housing is, let me see, I lost my little arrow. Most of your housing is within a 30-minute walk, and for some reason my finger went all sort of in this area, from what I understand, all around there. All of your different student apartments, but all within walking distance. So just to get to class on a daily basis, even no need for public transportation. The student apartments, just to give you a little more information, they all come with equipped kitchens, a living area, full bath with Wi-Fi and washing machines. No meals would be included except for the welcome and the goodbye receptions. Like I said, they're within a 30-minute walk and typically 4 to 6 students in double rooms. There is the opportunity to get a single room, but there would be a supplement that you would have to pay for. Mike went through all of the field trips and activities that you're going to do. I'm going to just show you a few more photos. We have a cooking class, the field trip to Siena and San Gimignano. The Rome optional tour is available to students for $5.25. It's a 3-day, 2-night trip. It includes transportation from Florence to Rome, accommodation there for all 2 nights, breakfast daily, and guided tours of all of the places that Mike mentioned. We also do an optional meal plan, 10 vouchers for $175, so it's $17.50 per meal, and they're valid for lunch in different lunch or dinner in local restaurants there in Florence. It seems to be very popular. I don't know if you have Any experience with the meal plan? You did it?
It was very, very convenient.
Yeah. Right, so it was worth having. I think it's a pretty good deal, right?
Yeah.
So you can sign up for this if you'd like to get it. And various cuisines, like they told me, it's not just Italian food. There's some options that are non-Italian. We also do the optional group flight. And you know what, John, I meant to ask you, did we have the price for the optional group flight? Because I wasn't CC'd on the email. Okay. Yeah, we don't have it yet. Okay, we have to ask for that because we got the civil one, we should have this. So there will be a group flight if you're interested. In the program fees, we do not include the round trip airfare because we'd like to give students the option of taking it or not if they don't want it. But there will be an optional round trip from LAX to Europe and then from a Europe city to Florence because there are no direct LAX to Florence. And we will also have, that would include pickup in the Florence airport from AIFS staff and then return transfer at the end of the program. And I didn't get CC'd on it, but we'll confirm that price with you as soon as possible. So just to give you your program fees, we have some scaled program fees. So it would be $2,945 for a group of 20 to 29 students. If we get over 30 students, the price would go down to $2,795. And that includes all of the things listed here that we all have already gone over, including your housing, your student center and staff, your orientation program and guided tour of Florence, all of the activities that we talked about that were not mentioned as optional. You do get a comprehensive medical insurance package included in the program fee that covers any incident that might or illness that happens to you. You need to seek medical treatment for up to $100,000 per incident. So that's really good medical insurance. The application fee is included, and all pre-departure services and orientation are included as well. The expenses not included, just to reinforce that, would be the round-trip airfare. Your community college tuition fees would not be included, so you'd be responsible for paying for the $46 per unit times 3 or 6 units, however you decided to take. If you do get the California Community College Promise Grant, which used to be called the BOG waiver, can be applied to your tuition fees. Textbooks would not be included. I'm not sure if you have textbooks, actually. They don't have any textbooks, so that's really good. Personal expenses, including your passport fees. If you don't have a passport yet, you need to get that as soon as possible. Make appointment at the Glendora Post Office as soon as we leave. A $125 room damage deposit would be applied, but would be refunded as long as you didn't do any damage to your accommodations or classroom or anything that we'd have to pay for to be repaired. It would be refunded, and meals except those two described. Eligibility requirements. How to apply? You start by going onto the Citrus College Study Abroad page, and there is an interest form there. There is actually under the Florence picture, you just click on that and there will be an interest form on a red bar right there. You can click on that and that's how you start your application. All right, there are scholarships available if you're a Pell eligible student. We highly encourage you to apply for this first one. It's the Gilman Scholarship. The deadline for the Gilman Scholarship is October 2nd. So you still have a few weeks to get that application together. It involves a personal statement essay and a follow-up project about just promoting study abroad on campus once you return. These links here are databases for different scholarships. You know, you don't have to just apply to a study abroad scholarship. You can apply to scholarships for college students. We encourage you to apply to as many as you possibly can. Getting one really good scholarship essay together and then just tweaking it and reusing it for other scholarships. We put together a PowerPoint full of scholarships to apply for, several study abroad scholarships to apply for, fundraising ideas, things that students are doing to raise funds. This is sort of a guaranteed return on investment, right? This creative funding. Scholarships you have to win, but raising funds is, you know, the more effort you put into it, the more funds you're going to raise. There's a little more guarantee return here. So students are doing a lot of this nowadays to raise funds, besides some back to basic ideas like getting a job, getting out of bed early, going and getting a side job, saving that money rather than, you know, spending on iTunes and Amazon Prime and all that good stuff. Students are doing that. They're doing garage sales. This student was, Christina, was a Chafee College student in Barcelona 2 years ago. She went around to her neighbors and asked for donations of stuff they didn't want anymore. You know, their goodwill box. Every mom in every home has a goodwill box. Stuff you don't want anymore, but it's too good to throw away. She gathered all that stuff and then had a 2-day giant garage sale and raised, I think, $1,500. So that's a really good return on investment. Students are doing crowdfunding like GoFundMe and Venmo. They're doing letter writing campaigns to local organizations asking about scholarships. Some parents that work for larger companies, they might have a scholarship matching program for, you know, children of their employees. Lifestyle changes, like we mentioned, stop buying Starbucks every day, make your coffee and bring it with you, stop buying bottled water, bring it with you, cutting down on those little Amazon Prime packages that end up at my front door often. You want to cut down on all of that. So those are really good ideas that students are doing. And then the last slide that we have is just talking about disclosing needs and accommodations. So studying abroad in a foreign country, even England, where we share a language, can be a challenge and can create a certain amount of stress. So it's important to really talk directly prior to applying with your study abroad advisor, your faculty, discuss all DSPS accommodations you may need, and talk about your expectations, any physical or mental health issues you might have, physical limitations, dietary limitations, medications you might have. We find that the student who does discuss all of this is better prepared for their experience abroad, and it makes their experience go a lot smoother help them deal with any health issues that they have. Okay. That's it. Yeah, so...
Thank you very much.
Thank you.